Wie abrupt das zusammensteht. Er hat jetzt so eine Stelle, wo so ein bisschen unnatürlich ist.
Das spielt sich schon am Blatt.
Ja.
Ja. Okay, so it's a pleasure to have here today Professor Sugiyama from the Riken Center in Tokyo. It's Professor Sugiyama is professor at the University of Tokyo, and we will be talking about supervised learning and robust machine learning in this context.
Okay, thank you very much for the kind introduction. And je m'appelle Masashi Sugiyama. That's my old friend. Okay, so thank you very much for the invitation. So I'm really excited to be here today. And my talk will be about recent advances in weakly supervised and robust machine learning. So before starting the talk, let me briefly introduce myself. So as also introduced, so I'm currently director at Riken Center for Advanced Intelligence. So this is actually a 10-year national project in Japan, started 2016. And we are working on like fundamentals of AI, also applications of AI, and ethics of AI. It's like a big center, and we have like more than 700 people. Then at the same time, I'm professor at the University of Tokyo and teaching computer science and taking care of students. And also, my lab is actually getting quite big now. I have about 50 students now at the University of Tokyo. Then I'm also doing some part-time consultants at several local startups like education, realtor, and advertising and wellness and things like that, and enjoying doing this kind of thing. Okay, then, so about my talk today. So nowadays, machine learning from big level data is really successful, like speech recognition, image understanding, natural language translation, recommendation, etc. But still, there are various application domains where massive level data is not really available. For example, at our Riken Center, we are interested in medical research, or disaster research, robotics, brain signal analysis, things like that. So in those applications, always human is involved in the data collection process, and we don't really have a huge number of data points. So the target of my talk today is that kind of situation. We only have limited information, but still we want to use machine learning. But my main point is that it's not about like classification from small data, because learning from small data is generally not really possible statistically, unless we have strong prior knowledge coming up. So instead, we consider some weak data, but we assume that we have many of them. So something, so n is the number of data points, and n should be large. But the question is, what is n? Either label data or unlabeled data or some other weak data. So that's the main point today. And the target problem is the simplest. I just consider binary supervised classification problem. So we have blue points and red points, and we just want to separate them. So we know that a large amount of labeled data is better classification accuracy, and estimation error of the decision boundary is in the order of 1 over square root of n, where n is the number of labeled data. So that's a standard result. But as I said, so gathering labeled data is sometimes close to me or sometimes impossible. So then let's consider the complete opposite, extreme opposite. So learning from only from unlabeled data. So we only have black points like this, and they are not labeled yet. And hopefully we can collect unlabeled data quite cheaply. Then typically, unsupervised classification is just clustering. So we want to separate this point. We need to separate this point into like one cluster and the other cluster. And this unsupervised clustering works quite well as a supervised classification method. If one cluster corresponds to one class, like all top left clusters are blue and all bottom right clusters are red or something like that, then clustering works perfectly as a classification method. But in reality, maybe it's not that simple. So the clustering method is not really useful for supervised classification purposes. Then people have studied semi-supervised classification for long years. So they want to utilize a large number of unlabeled data in addition to a small number of labeled samples. But still, the way they solve the problem is somewhat similar to unsupervised classification. basically they do some kind of clustering, either implicitly or explicitly. But now we have additional label point here. So then we can basically propagate this blue color over this cluster and this red color over this cluster. But again, we have the same problem. So if one cluster corresponds to one class, then it works well. But otherwise, it doesn't. And this method works really well for MNIST dataset. But for other real-world datasets, unfortunately, it doesn't work well. So then summary so far is like this. So I took the classification accuracy on the horizontal axis and the labeling cost on the vertical axis. Then supervised learning is the most accurate, but it costs quite high. So it's located on the top right corner. Then unsupervised classification, its labeling cost is minimum, but classification accuracy is usually low. So it's located in the bottom left corner. The semi-supervised classification may be located somewhere here. So we wanted it to be much better, but in reality, it doesn't work so well. So then we clearly have an open space here. So this is our target. We want to have classification method that have high accuracy with low labeling cost. So that's the target today. And we have been working on this topic for the last 5 years or so. And hopefully I can provide you some ideas today. So then this is the list of methods I want to introduce today. So we have a lot of acronyms, P, N, U, things like that. So P is positive, N is negative, U is unlabeled. Then conf is confidence, S is similar, then comp is complementary. We have a lot of like weak data, and we want to learn from those weak data. And if you have, by the way, any questions, you can just interrupt me and ask questions. Then I start from PU classification. So on positive and unlabeled data. The situation is like this. Still, the problem is the same. So I want to separate blue points and red points. But in this situation, we only have blue points and black points, unlabeled. And we don't have any single negative point. But still, the goal is to separate blue and red. So this kind of situation happens, for example, in click prediction. Like we want to predict whether a user want to like, click this link or not, or like this link or not. Then positive data can be easily collected by looking at the history of clicks. They are all positive links. But non-click links are actually quite difficult to handle. We want to regard non-click links as like unfavored clicks, but not necessarily true, because sometimes user likes those links, but they didn't have enough time to click those links. So then basically, unclicked links are unlabeled data. They can be either positive points or negative points. So then in that kind of scenario, we naturally have only blue point, positive points and unlabeled points, but we want to separate blue and red. So that's the target problem here. So to solve this problem, we define the risk of a classifier in a standard way. So we consider a certain loss function L. It can be like Hinze loss or square loss or whatever. Then we have point-wise loss here. And this loss is expected over all data points coming from P of X and Y. So that's a kind of standard definition of classification risk or generalization error. And we typically decompose this risk into a positive part and negative part. Then, so in the standard like supervised learning, we have both positive data and negative data. Then this risk for positive data is estimated from positive data. Then this risk for negative data is estimated from negative data. So that's standard empirical risk minimization. But in this current PU learning setup, we don't have negative data. So we can't directly estimate this down. So this is the technical challenge we need to tackle here. And one thing I have to explain here is like, pi is the classifier probability, so P of Y plus 1. So this is unknown in reality, and we need to estimate it from data. But already we have several nice methods here, and they work only from positive and unlabeled data. So to make the story simple, today I assume that pi is already known. But in reality, so given PU data, we estimate pi and we relate this pi with an estimated quantity. But today I just assume pi is unknown. Pi is no. So then we just tackle the second risk for negative data. Then luckily we have a very simple trick to estimate the second term. Because now we know that unlabeled data is a mixture of positive and negative data. Then suppose unlabeled data tends to be something like this, black one. Then we have positive data distribution like this and negative data distribution like this. And we have class proportions pi and 1 minus pi. then so we naturally have this kind of mixing equation. But now we have unlabeled data, so that's coming from P, and we have positive data coming from this positive density. Then it's straightforward that this term can be estimated by moving this first term to the left-hand side. So that's the only trick we use. So more specifically, so given the risk function, we decompose this into positive part and negative part. And this expectation over negative data cannot be handled directly. But based on this equation coming from the previous case, we just replace this part with these two terms. Then in the end, we have the expression of risk like this. So first term is to the positive data risk, and second part, second and third term correspond to the negative risk. Then if you look at this equation, we only have expectation over positive point here and here, and expectation over unlabeled data point. So then we can just simply use end data risk analysis from only positive and unlabeled data. Is the story clear so far? So then it's basically done. So we can now solve the problem.
So then, yeah. You need to assume a particular form of the distribution?
So it can be anything. So we just assume that data points are IID from some true distribution.
And you know them?
No, it's unknown.
It's just a parameterized function.
It doesn't have to be. So we just need samples.
Okay.
And just expectation is replaced by sample average without having any parametric form. So that's like the best estimate of the mean. Okay, so far actually I didn't assume anything, but the samples are coming from some distribution IIP. And also I didn't have any assumption on the model F. And I will talk about it a bit later, but F can be anything. It can be either linear model or CNN or LSTM or whatever. So no assumption on the model. Then suppose model is a linear function, linear model, then we can have a simple like, estimation error bounds. I don't really go into the detail, but the important point is we have 1 over square root of NP here, and 1 over square root of NU here. So NP and NU are the number of data points from P and U. So we know that 1 over square root of N is basically the best order we can achieve. So then this estimation error bounds already means that this simple empirical risk minimization approach is optimal. And once we perform the same analysis for PN learning, standard supervised learning, then we have a similar upper bound like this. And again, we have 1 over square root of NP here and 1 over square root of NN here. Again, it is optimal. Then, so PU learning and also PN learning achieve the optimal convergence rate from this analysis. But now, actually, we can compare these two bounds because actually we have the common constants here. Then, so this is actually quite interesting because we started this PU learning research as a kind of compromise because we can't collect negative data. So instead, let's use unlabeled data. So that was a compromise. But by comparing these two bounds, actually, we can show that under some condition, PU learning can be better than PL learning. So this PU learning can be better than standard supervised learning. The condition is really like this. I just compared these two bounds. If you have a large number of positive points, then left-hand side tends to be small. And if you have a large number of unlabeled data, also left-hand side tends to be small. Then if you have only a small number of negative points, then right-hand side tends to become large. So that means if you only have a small number of negative data, then instead of relying on these small number of negative points, using a large number of unlabeled points is actually better. So this is the kind of theoretical finding. And I think it's quite interesting and productive. And I will show later that this really happens in reality. Okay, that's one thing. So we kind of solved the PU learning problem. But unfortunately, the naive method doesn't really work well. So I'd like to explain the reason why. So what we have done so far was we decomposed the classification risk into P part and N part. And N part was further decomposed into these two terms based on this mixing. But then like, the problem is this minus term. So suppose now loss function is non-negative, then by definition, this risk for P data is non-negative, and also this risk for negative data is non-negative. But now second term is decomposed into P2, and we have minus term here. And by definition, these two terms are still non-negative. Let's say like 3 minus 2 or something like that. But now, in reality, we estimate each term based on sample average. Then originally it was 3 minus 2, but now 3 is estimated from data and 2 is also estimated from data. And sometimes it becomes like 2 minus 4 or something. Then it can become negative. So this is actually quite problematic. And we found that this negative problem really happens if we use a flexible model like deep neural network. So let's see a numerical example. We use the standard MNIST or something here, and we did backprop iteration. Then if we use like positive and negative data in a standard way, then the training error drops like this blue dotted line. So over iteration, it converges nicely. Then at the same time, test error also decreases nicely like this, and it converges to a reasonable number. But if we use PU learning, then the training error drops like this, and at some point, it becomes negative and it really goes down like this. Then interestingly, so if you see the test error, it starts to overfit like this. So this may be understandable because training error should be non-negative, but because of this negative issue, so we have a large negative value like this. But this is a clear indication of overfit. And we wanted to somehow avoid this issue. Then we decided to constrain basically the sample approximation term to be non-negative, like this. So this was the original term, and we just took max 0. So once that those two terms become negative, we just round it up to 0.
So I don't understand how can you estimate. So from your previous slides,
yeah.
I understood that you had an expectation and
yeah. So just
given the y equal 1 and given nothing.
Yeah.
So you bring the third term into the, I thought you were bringing the third term into the first.
No, actually we are still, okay, separating and just first term is, you know, first term. I just handle it as it is. The second term and third term are together for risk for negative data.
Okay, but I don't know, so in the next slide, I don't understand how you compute expectation.
Okay, so, under, okay, okay. These are just shorthand notation. Maybe I didn't really define it carefully, but just these two together. Then the expectation is just replaced by the sample average.
Okay.
So that's just short-term notation here. So then, okay, once the empirical term becomes negative, we just round it up to 0.
Okay, but when you do this at every minimatch, right?
Yeah, yeah, for each minimatch, we need to do this.
Okay, okay. So you crown this part at 0 for every minimatch.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so then, okay, originally we justified our estimator as because it is unbiased and we have this kind of bar. But now, because of this max zero trick, it is biased. So then we need to somehow re-justify our estimator. So then I don't really go into the detail here, but we have some nice theoretical analysis like about consistency and bias decreases exponentially. Our squared error is actually it's smaller, and also the learned model is has optimal convergence. We can somehow justify the use of this max zero. Then, so let's see some experimental results. This is really actually remarkably improved. So, okay, we use some binarized version of CIFAR-10 dataset. Then for PN learning, blue ones, again, the training error decreases like this and it converges to zero nicely. Then test error also drops and converges nicely. Then PU learning without any modification, again, you know, goes to negative like this, training error. So then test error increases. It didn't work. But if you have the max zero trick, then the training error decreases like this and kept non-negative like this. So then the test error is also kept lower like this. And in the end, so this number is actually smaller than the PL test error. So this setting was actually a bit artificial because we chose the number of data points to satisfy this inequality. We have only a small number of negative data and large number of unnegative data. But then, so clearly, so in that situation, we can like, improve PN learning. So PN learning standard supervised learning. So PU learning can be better than PN learning. So that's like an interesting finding here. Okay, so this is a summary of PU learning. So things are a bit complicated, but in the end, what we have done was quite simple. We are basically separating blue points and black points. So the idea is, so black points are a mixture of red points and blue points. Right? So we regard black points and unlabeled data as noisy negative data. And then we separate blue and black. But once we separate blue and black directly, then okay, it's biased. Our decision boundary is located somewhere here. So it doesn't work. Then to make things unbiased, okay, we are changing the loss function. So as François said, we have some manipulations here. We can actually consider some composite loss function by combining these two. So then essentially, so we define loss function L tilde in this way. Then we are actually using L tilde for positive data, blue points, and L for unlabeled data. Then by using this different loss functions, we can like, systematically eliminate the bias caused by this PU system. Then we can establish the optimal convergence flow. Then if loss function satisfies this symmetric condition, for example, satisfied by the round loss, then so L tilde essentially becomes the same as L. Then we are essentially using the same loss function for P and U. Or if L tilde is a linear function, then the optimization problem becomes convex. And L tilde becomes becomes linear if L is a squared loss function, or logistic loss function, or double hinge loss. So we need two hinges here and here. So these loss functions satisfy this function. Then finally, we have shown that for deep net, rounding up the empirical force net error to zero really improves the performance. So that was the summary of PU classification so far. Do you have any questions?
Okay, I would have 20 questions.
Yeah.
It's still unclear why is it that when the loss becomes negative, it's so much of a time. So it looks like standard overfitting. So what is happening is that during the training, there is an incentive in insisting on those points where the loss is negative to get even.
In the standard case, we are just estimating that this expectation by sample average and this expectation by sample average. Then still, non-negativity is always kept automatically.
Yes.
So then we just use standard rather than this error. But in our case, we decompose this second term into like A minus B. Because of this minus sign, some strange things.
Ah, okay. So it's not obvious. It's not obvious what is actually happening. Because it could perfectly work. So you could have still a trade-off which makes sense.
Yeah, like by definition, these two terms are still non-negative.
Exactly.
If we have infinity data point. But because of this small finite sample effect, it can be negative. Okay. And if we use a flexible model, this almost always becomes negative.
So it has a way of really pushing those guys even more and more negative.
Essentially, like we can just reduce the second term as small as possible. So that's the problem. But by this max zero artificial fit, we can somehow prevent that effect. Yeah, that was PU learning. Now we can solve a classification problem only from positive and unlabeled data. And this is like the kind of start of weakly supervised learning phase. We have a lot of different methods, and they are kind of variation of PU learning. But then let's start from PMU learning. So this is simple. The PMU learning is basically semi supervised classification. We have all positive, negative, unlabeled data. So then, we have blue points, red points, and black points. And our idea is to decompose this problem into PU, PN, and NU. Because now we have a method to solve PU learning problem. And NU learning is essentially the same as PU learning. We can use the same method. Then PN learning is the standard supervised learning. We can use whatever algorithms. Then basically, we can solve each of them separately. Then why don't we just add them up together? We have learning criteria for PU learning, PN learning, NU learning, just combine them. That's the solution. So then the next small question is, so how to combine these three criteria? So we may just have two hyperparameters and just tune them based on classification. That's fine. But we wanted to make it as simple as possible. So we wanted to choose two of three. Then I thought, naturally, we may choose PU learning and NU learning because they are kind of symmetric. But we found that, so based on some theoretical risk analysis, combining PU and NU are not really the best combination.
So I don't really go into the detail, but we show that if PU is better than NU, so we have some order like this, the other way like this. And if you want to choose best two problems, then so PU and NU are not the best. But combining PU PM or NU PM are actually the best combination, at least from the theoretical risk analysis. And also empirically, we confirm this phenomenon quite clearly. So then, okay, things are a bit complicated, but in the end, what we are doing is quite straightforward. So we have PU learning, PN learning, NU learning, and introduce one hyperparameter, eta. And if eta is minus one, we just use PU learning. Then if eta is increased, then it has more influence of PN learning. And then if eta is zero, we just use the, we don't use unlabeled eta. Then if eta is further increased, it goes to NU learning. So we just, you know, control the balance based on this eta hyperparameter. And this eta is chosen based on post-validation system. So that's the final method. And then we can actually show that this is actually quite interesting. But we can actually upper bound the generalization error in this way. And let's look at this term. So we have 1 over square root of NU term. So NU is the number of unlabeled data. So this basically shows that our generalization error decreases we increase the number of unlabeled data. And in this derivation, actually, we didn't have any assumption on clusters or whatever. We are just assuming that data points are coming from IID from some distribution. So that's standard setup. But we can guarantee that the generalization error decreases if we have more unlabeled data. So to the best of our knowledge, I think this is the first result that we obtain this kind of optimal order without having additional cluster assumption. And more technically, the way we use unlabeled data is quite different from previous semi-supervised learning. But in the previous methods, basically unlabeled data is used for regularization, for label propagation. Like we wanted to propagate labels over clusters. That was basically regularization, so biases are. But in our case, our method is based on PU learning. And in PU learning, as I said, U data is regarded as noisy. For NU learning, U data is regarded as noisy P data. And we are using unlabeled data for loss validation. So meaning that it is used for reducing the bias. But in regularization, unlabeled data is used for reducing the variance. So the way unlabeled data is used is actually quite different. So we are somehow extracting label information from unlabeled data. So that's why we achieve 1 over square root of NU. Even without any cluster assumption. Then we did some toy experiments here. Then of course, it's not that easy to say like new method works really well, but at least because of this bound, we can guarantee that our method is safe. Because sometimes if you use a standard semi-supervised classification method, then if the cluster assumption is not really satisfied, then the performance can be even worse than like original supervised learning, only from small number of data. But this didn't really happen in experiment. We had several famous various methods. Some are working quite well sometimes. But performance is quite like unstable in a sense. But our method is quite stable in this way. I can't simply say like, our method is quite good, but at least our method is safe. And it is theoretically done. That's the outcome here. Okay, that was PNU classification. Then let's try to now reduce further supervision. Like we started from PU learning, but now, yeah, so now next one is p-conf classification. So in PU learning, we assume that P and U data are available.
But sometimes even unable data is not available. For example, if we work for some company that analyzes customer data, then we are not allowed to access the database of other companies because of some privacy issue. So in that case, we can only access the database of our own company, only positive data, only data from one company. But then, so in conclusion, so learning from like only P data is not really possible. It's basically the same as one class classification and unsupervised learning. We can't really train a classifier system accurately. But we found that if positive data is equipped with confidence, so I described it as R, it's actually class posterior probability. Then actually we can solve the problem. So it is called P conf classification, positive confidence classification. So okay, basically we are following the same recipe. So we first define the classification list like this. And naively, like we may think if like one point is 80% positive, then that point is 20% negative. Like we may have like 80% here as positive data, then okay, 20% as negative data. So that's the standard way of like weighting data points. But actually we can show that this is not the right way, because this doesn't agree with the true risk. Because our data is coming only from positive class. Actually, the right expression is a bit similar, but it's like this. We just need a few lines to derive this, but we have this. So then it's 1 minus R over R. So this is the right way. Then we can indeed use empirical risk minimization approach to obtain the criteria like this. Then again, the problem can be solved. And one lucky thing is we have class prior pi here. But now this is just a proportional constant. We can drop it. We don't have to estimate pi. So that's simple, but it's a p-conf classification. Then we can simply show that again, so convergence rate is 1 over square root of n, so it's optimal in some sense. And we did some experiments. Actually, experiments are a bit difficult here because there's no clear baseline to compare. And if we compare our method with PN learning, then of course PN learning is the best. It works best. But if we compare our method with the naive weighted method that I have shown wrong, then our method is better than this weighted one. So but if you see
So if you come back to the previous slide, so there is something that seems a bit problematic that you have this Ri at the denominator.
Right. So we are assuming that Ri is like non-negative. So meaning that basically positive class really covers the entire domain. So basically we are using important something.
Okay. Because at the same time it seems it could create some numerical instability, but on the other, so the loss should be very small for this one. So that